Welcome to Torah Talk, a Torah Institute podcast.
Torah just means instruction in Hebrew. At Torah Talk, we will make straight the ways of Yahuwah and discuss the simple truths of Scripture so that even you can understand and get all the juicy life hidden within the pages of Yahuwah's Torah. Welcome to Torah Talk with Lou White and Mark Davidson.
It's the Torah Zone. Good morning, brother.
Good morning and good evening. What is it? Closing in on midnight for you.
Yeah, it's 11:03.
Wow. Is this the first time you've called?
Yes.
Good. Okay. Yes. Yeah. I noticed. I looked up and it was 8 o'clock and I went, oh, he's probably already called. So I had just turned on my Skype, and that's great.
Yeah, I can. The Skype actually tells me when you log on.
What?
So, yeah, because so isn't it? Yeah, Big Brother, man. It's
I was just putting on my goggles here to look up. Something had gone through my head about the last day, and I was wondering where they got this idea of drawing water from the Kidron and bringing it up on the last day of the festival. And, it reminded me of Yahuchanan or John chapter 7, which the whole chapter is really about the period of the Feast of Sukkoth. You know, it's really interesting. It talks about living water, and, you know. But anyway, Yahusha was talking about that. You know, we were talking about Simchat Torah. And Simchat Torah is today, the 22nd of the moon. And it is just amazing. And remember, when we talk about Torah Talk, we're talking about Yahusha. Yeah. I don't know what I look like. What do I look like with glasses on?
I don't know. More intelligent? I don't know. Distinguished?
Sort of a sea captain physicist.
Yeah, like that that guy at the Titanic. The captain.
Yeah. Yeah, the captain of the ship. You know, Phyllis wants to buy me a sea captain hat.
Yes.
I don't know. Wow. That would be. But anyway, I had emailed you about how Yahuwah has been making me think about Vikings for some reason.
Yeah, what's that about? You know,
I don't know, but I bet their boats were awesome. I mean, we read about the history of the Israelites and how rugged those boats were and how many hundreds of people could fit on one of these enormous boats, and they had to be strong boats. And then you remember how we recalled from some of the research that had been done by some brothers about how they used to disguise the ships with these really big sea creature look like dragon heads on the front of the ship. What? Did you hear that?
Yeah, it was on flush the toilet.
No, it was actually one of those sea creatures. I don't know what that was. I've got this program that's very nautical and, you know. But anyway, it was really exciting to read the research about these ships with these animal heads. And they weren't there to, entertain the people on board. They were there to frighten off distant ships that would mistake them for one of these mythological creatures that was out there in the ocean.
Oh, I get it.
Vikings were Israelites, you know.
Vikings were, of course, yeah. Makes sense.
Yeah.
Wow.
Oh, wow.
I wonder if the savage-like natures was true, or is that just a myth? Because they were savage, weren't they?
Well, yeah, I guess they were, but they were also very, friendly towards themselves. I mean, they were outsiders, it was pretty brutal. You know, I've heard a lot of things about Teutonic hordes descending from the hills with mud smeared all over their bodies and no clothes on. And their hair was long and the mud had, they put the mud on the hair and the mud was frozen. You know, so these guys that we see with the green hair and the spikes and stuff, that's not new, you know.
Wow.
this.
Yep.
What?
Go for it.
Alrighty then.
It looks like cover. It looks like it's got a bit of a mother of pearl feel to it in the light.
It really is amazing. The finish that's on these horns, Yehua has done a wonderful thing. It's like he's decorated the horns of the animals with like fingernail polish. I don't know if they put anything on this or not, but it is amazing. You know, these kind of remind me of like giant, like fingernails or, you know, that's the kind of material it's made of. For those of you that don't know what they're made of, they're horns, you know. How about that?
That's wonderful.
We did it last night as the sunset, and Simchat Torah was starting the eighth day, the closing day. Adam said, "What do you think? Let's go out there and wake up the neighborhood." Of course, we went out there and we blew our shofars, and you know, just as a kind of a closing thing. But have you been able to pick up a shofar yet?
Not yet. We've seen some online. I think we're going to aim to get one for next year.
Great.
Yeah.
Well, you ought to get for the spring feast. You know, do you
blow them at Passover and those festivals too?
We look for any excuse. Yeah. Yeah, we don't limit ourselves on the blowing of the shofar. Yeah.
That's great. I would get one before then.
Yeah. So where are we today?
Today we are at a lovely, stunning sunset, or it could be sunrise. I stand corrected. And you can see in the background the cube, New Jerusalem, as you can see, coming down from the clouds. Well, it's not coming down. It's a still. Someone's taken a shot of it. It's amazing because it's Simchat Torah. It's the marriage. So it's the new city, and it's amazing. Yeah.
And Sukkoth is the word in Hebrew for tent or booth, and it is about our dwelling place. He said, "I have my father has many dwelling places in his mansion." Well, many mansions is what they see in the translation, in my father's house. And it's really great because that's what we're talking about. Yeah, that's a very appropriate setting.
Yeah.
Very.
Yeah.
Anyway, the living waters. Yeah. You know, that's what Yehusha was talking about during the Feast of Tabernacles. And the living waters refer to the spirit, you know, the Ruach HaKodesh, the spirit of Messiah, Mashiach, you know, flowing out from his people, you know, into many others. So what were you going to say?
Is that, I'm interested in what you're saying. Is that part of the prophecy that where you're saying it starts off and it's shallow and then it flows from the temple and it gets deeper, ankles, and then, is that that scripture?
Well, you know, the water pouring ceremony that was done on the last day of the festival, which we see Yehusha responding to in John chapter 7, you know, and that would refer, in the understanding of the rabbis, the ones that call themselves rabbis, that water coming into the temple area symbolized the Gentiles, too. It had that interpretation. So the waters were the peoples of the world coming in and observing and you know, basically observing the festival of Sukkoth and the environment of the Torah. And but it also, like you were saying, if you read Revelation chapter 22, the same thing is described. Living waters being flowing out. Let me see if I can find that Deuteronomy 22. It's going to be really great if we can read Torah. Well, I'll read aspects of Torah here. Okay, Revelation 22, starting at verse 1. "And he showed me a river of water of life, bright as crystal, proceeding out of the throne of Elohim and of the Lamb, in the midst of the street thereof. And on this side of the river, and on that, was the tree of life, bearing 12 manners of fruits, yielding its fruit every moon. And the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. Wow. Well, there's that water of life. Yeah, and the Torah will flow forth from Jerusalem, and then, you know, as the waters cover the ocean, all mankind will know about Yahuwah, and they'll know his name. That's really great.
Yeah. Todd was saying something interesting in the last chapter of his book, The Messiah, and he was saying, interestingly, with the New Jerusalem, there's 12 gates. There's not a gate for the Gentiles and a gate for the Christians. The gates that are there are the gates for the 12 tribes of Israel. So you can't replacement theologize out the tribes of Israel and say that the CHURCH is now where you're meant to be, because it says even in Revelation, which is, you know, Christians are happy to use the New Testament, and Revelation says there's 12 gates, 12 tribes. What do you think of that?
Well, that's true. And then they get around that by saying, well, we are now the spiritual Israel, and that's the way they usurp the title Israel or Yisrael. And, you know, but actually in reality, since Abraham is the father of nations, then all mankind descends in some part from everybody alive, has some component physically from Abraham. I mean, after all, this dough or this yeast that was put into the dough, being Abraham, has leavened the whole lump of mankind. And he's all over the place. And you can't just look at somebody and say, well, that can't be. That, look at that race. That can't be the person. But the Chinese people, the Korean people, the Japanese people, the African people, the Viking people like yourself and myself. I mean, the Vikings were all over the place in the European theater, you know, and they were seagoing. You know, they were very boat-oriented. And what does that remind us of? Well, all of mankind has been leavened with the same, you know, seed. And, of course, the one seed, Yahusha, which is the living Torah, which is what we're so excited about, you know, he comes into us and brings us his covenant. And that joy that we're experiencing, and we remember on Simchat Torah, the joy of Torah, that day, today, is the indwelling of his spirit. And it's all about living water. Christians are not explained. They're not told about the Torah. They don't even know. In fact, most people who are Christians, there goes that big sea creature again.
Oh, tell them to shut the bathroom door.
What? Anyway, what I'm thinking is that this, you know, experience that we're all having with the Spirit is the living water.
Yeah.
And it's the Ruach HaKodesh, the Spirit of Messiah coming in and giving us the joy of knowing not only who we are in relationship to him, because he's the only one that's important. You know, we're not important, but he's loved us so much. His love is so overwhelming that he's just seeking and searching and grabbing us and saying, if you will, receive this water, if you're thirsty. That's what he was saying in John chapter 7. Let him who thirsts, you know, come to me and drink. And yeah, that's what we're feeling today, you know. It's really exciting. And it's not complicated. In that email I sent you, I mentioned keep it pure and simple, not pure and complicated.
Yeah.
You know, that doesn't work out very well.
You've got a very squeaky chair there, brother.
I'm going to have to lose some weight. Yeah, Phyllis keeps complaining about this chair, too. She sits over here at her desk to my left, and she goes, what's with that chair? Wow. You know, and it's squeaking, and I'm moving around. Sorry. Anyway, I'll try to keep still.
That's all right. No problem.
Right. Tell us more about the book, Todd Bennett's book.
Well, he has a part in here. Very interesting thing he says is that he doesn't blame Judaism or the Jews for not receiving the Messiah, because the Messiah that Christianity puts forth, according to Torah, doesn't qualify as a Messiah. He's saying the Christian Messiah, because J-E-S-U-S, because something about the main role of Messiah coming was to restore the tribes, bring the tribes back together. That's what Israel was waiting for, and they don't think he's done that. Well, he hasn't done it yet, but he's so that's one reason they don't receive J-E-S-U-S or even Yahusha a lot of the time.
There's so many misunderstandings too. Terminology, the Greek, the languages. One Israelite that was born in Israel, he came to visit me several years ago, and he spoke English really rather well. It was his second language, but I asked him a very important question. I said, what is it that makes the people that are raised in Orthodox Judaism, Rabbinical Judaism, as you were, why don't they believe in the Messiah? And he said, well, the main reason that they don't is because the name doesn't mean anything to them, the name the Christians use. And that barrier has kept them from it. They don't know anything about that. That it's Greek, it's Latinized, it's Anglicized, and it doesn't have any roots whatsoever in any Hebrew words. And so the Messiah, he has to come in the Father's name, and of course the prophecies, over 300 prophecies, were fulfilled by Yahusha. And I was explaining to him that the name, he wasn't really quite committed yet, but he was on the verge himself. He was searching. And of course, it was really Yahusha, you know, guiding him and prodding him and goading him. But he heard me say the name. And he said, now that makes sense. That's his name. And I said, well, go back to the Greek, look at the Hebrew word Joshua. And then you notice in Acts 7 and Hebrews 4, underlying that word is the five-lettered spelling that's referred to all through the Tanakh. And the same letters in the Greek that underlie Joshua are the name of the Messiah, which means that they had the same name, these two people, these two men, the Messiah and the successor of Moshe. So when you understand the meaning of his name, Yahusha, then you see that it talks about deliverance. The root Yasha for deliverance. What? Means deliverance. And Yahusha together with that means Yah is our deliverer, you know. So that's pretty exciting. And I saw the gears grinding in his head because he realized that the name was withheld. And the key of knowledge, as we understand it, the Christians don't know. They think the key of knowledge is some other assortment of various things. But the key of knowledge that was withheld by the Pharisees and the scribes and the Sadducees was the prohibition of his name being uttered aloud. So they didn't know his name. Most of the masses did not know his name. And the name in the book of Acts is the thing that was turning the whole world upside down. Actually, it was setting it right. Because everybody was already upside down, like we are today around us. We're not upside down, but we're perceived as being freaks or, you know, like your family thinks you're a legalist. And, you know, it's the Torah has changed us. You know, if there isn't a change, then there would be no distinction between one who possesses the spirit of Messiah and one that does not, you know. But not that we're judging, you know. I mean, if we get severe with them, then we have to love them into the kingdom, because that's the only motivation. And because Yahusha loved us first, and then we let that living water pour out into the world through us, and we guide people back. And, you know, one of the saddest things is that among the Nazarene, there's so much anger and contention and even striving for dominance. But really, the one that we want to win is Yahusha, not ourselves. We don't care about ourselves. We're just a vapor. We're only here to get his work done through us as he puts us on like a glove and says, I want to use you today. And he uses us. And if we're doing it, it's not going to have any lasting nothing. I mean, if we gain the whole world, we haven't really done anything because it will not last. But whatever he does is permanent, and he'll bring people, he'll draw people to himself, and you know, when they hear the pure truth and it's simple, it's pure and it's simple, then they go, wow, when I was handing one of my books to someone, it was a gentleman that was very, very kind man, and he was getting up in years, and he says, I'm getting where I can actually find time to do some research, and I can read. And I said, well, how would you like to read something? And he said, I'd like to. And I handed him one of my copies of Fossilized Customs. And I said, now, in this book, there's going to be a lot of different words that you're not used to. But when you read this book, you're going to find that the words that you've been taught are just coverings for the real thing. And he's going to find out just amazing things. It was just a couple of days ago. But that's the thing we have to do. We have to dig and uncover things and say, well, what's hiding here? Who put this cover over this name, you know? And that's what was the stumbling block and has been the stumbling block for all the Orthodox in the land of Israel and all around the world, is the name doesn't mean anything to them. But it's a very powerful name. It's the name above all names, you know? Yahusha, or Yahushua, you know? A lot of people get upset about the spelling, but how we say it or whatever. But the meaning of the name in Hebrew is just the real key to this thing, and Yahuwah is the center of it. I'm sorry for talking so long. There's a cheer again.
That's wonderful. Yeah. That's fabulous, mate. He was saying also that a popular misconception is that things concerning the end have been and will remain a mystery. Saying that's a misconception. When approached with the subject of the end of the ages and the return of Yahusha, many Christians instinctively parrot the response that no man knows the day or the hour of his return. Many also claim that he could return at any time. Both of these statements ignore the fact that the scriptures provided very specific information concerning his first coming. Should it be any different with his return? And he goes on to say that if you're watching and you're in Torah, and you will know the time of his coming. He says it comes as a thief in the night, but if you're sitting there watching for a thief, you'll see him come. You won't be caught unawares, which we found amazing, because he goes on to say about the in the Hebrew custom, the bridegroom would meet the bride, would tell the bride, I'm going away to prepare a place for you, to prepare a place in his father's house or wherever, and he would give, and then he would leave, and then he would send servants to let the bride know that he's on his way, because, as Todd says, he doesn't want to spend maybe months or years preparing a place for his bride and then come back and find that she's not even ready. So he's saying we should be, he's going to send servants, which we sort of gathered would be witnesses or, you know, so to let us know, look, it's really coming close now. He's coming. So we can know that he'll be coming very shortly, and which we found amazing. You know, because he says, how does he feel if he comes back and the bride's not ready? She's disheveled. She's not even interested. You know, he's been longing and wanting her. And if she's not ready, it shows that she's not, doesn't care or doesn't have the same love that he has, which is heartbreaking. So he'll make sure we know, because he wouldn't do all this if he was going to leave us unaware. So those who are his bride, he wants them to know when he's coming back so that we can be ready.
Exactly. And that's exactly the way I feel too. Todd is absolutely 100% correct. And the bride is going to know the season. Not only that, but we'll know the imminent return, because he said that, you know, when you see these things happening, beginning to come about, then know that he is at the door. There's, I can't remember the reference. I was just reading it last night, as a matter of fact, which is amazing, because the prophecy is that the bride is going to experience warnings, you know, and signals that we're watching for, because it's all about, like you were saying, watching. You know, he says to all to watch, and that's a key to this, because when the year comes that he's going to return, it will not be a surprise for us. He said, he talked about those of the world who are of darkness are sleeping, because they're in the darkness. That's when people sleep. But whether we're awake or asleep, we're watching, because we're going to be aware, and we are going to know, you know, and the signals are there. We're more aware now of so many little things that are simple, but yet we're not known, just in the last generation. You know, there's just amazing things, and I think we're going to be seeing something even more profound. But we've got to get over the rivalry, and we've got to get more on the teamwork aspect of this, and overcome these little differences and say, well, you know, we're all moving through this race, and we're at different places in the race, and we need to just encourage one another, but not be condemning of them. You know, if someone has some information that was revealed, they don't need to use it as an instrument of competition or being hurtful, but to be gentle and guide the ones that are trying to catch up, especially the newcomers. When they see us arguing and being combative and rivaling, it's just wrong. The newcomers, it's really for, they're the front lines. They're the ones that we're working so hard for. They're the ones that, the gentle sheep that are completely lost, that are coming in, and they see all these bickering and, you know, what are you talking about? You know, the moon and, you know, hell doesn't exist? Well, sure it does. Well, the lake of fire certainly exists. But we can't be arguing about all these things that we have no control over, you know. We have to be cooperative and have a team spirit, you know. And the team spirit would be looking at Yahushua rather than some leader somewhere, you know. You know what I mean?
Yeah, totally.
Because let Yahushua guide us. Yeah. But we will know the day and the hour. Yeah. Although it is, you know, it's more or less the way you read it, and it's not for those on the outside to know, you know, but the ones that know, that have His Spirit, He knows when He's going to be returning. It isn't like the Father's saying, "Okay, go now," and like the Son doesn't know. You know, He knows. Yeah, but he didn't. He was withheld from that at that time. You know, that information. But yeah, is there another aspect of that book that about the Messiah that?
From what you were saying as well, I think it's just amazing. From previous weeks, you've been talking about Messiah's fulfillment of the latter feasts, and I think. And we went through the book as well. He talks in great detail about just how many little intricate things of the scriptures that Yahushua actually fulfilled. Things that he you know, didn't supernaturally, you know, do by accident. He knew he was fulfilling them. So he walked along and he did this to fulfill that. And he did that to fulfill that, to prove that he was, and to fulfill all the Torah behind him, you know, and so when you look at the latter feasts that aren't fulfilled yet, you think, well, surely he's got to fulfill them. And so from when you were saying he'll come back at this point and he'll, you know, round about and then this will happen, then this will happen, well, I think it was spot on from what we've been understanding. There's so much orchestration went into the first coming. Like you said, he's not just going to go ready, he said, go now, you know, why would he? It's, everything is going to be, he does everything in order. So.
On time, yeah. If everything's planned out, there's a specific time, and it's all going to be on schedule. But, of course, it's not for us to, it's outside of our purview and our authority to set a date, but we know that the time is getting closer and closer and closer, while the other people of the world are going, oh, well, it's been so long now. And most of the people that are in religion, are just saying, well, things are going to just keep going on. And that's the same mindset that, you know, the Yahudim had where they, when they had taken over the religion part of this whole thing. I mean, it's not about religion. It's about reality. I mean, this is real. This is not some man-made thing or some scheme that we have to go through by rote or, you know, some, well, it's just time to do this. Let's get the tree and put the ornaments on it. Well, you know, it's just not about any of that, you know. This is about his temple and his bride. And Sukkoth is like the time when he takes us into his booth and we're married, you know. And there's going to be an outpouring of spirit that's going to be unbelievably powerful in each one of us. And right now all we have is a little tiny little bit of a scrap piece of that spirit. And it speaks to us inside of us. And but when he's fully in control of us, it's going to be, okay, I'm getting out of the way of this. This is great. You know, instead of us trying to steer each other's vehicles and, you know, try to steer our own vehicle down the road, we need to just get out of the way and let the spirit of Yahusha take control and keep our eyes on him and not listen to, you know, all these little winds of doctrine and, you know, false messages, you know, like we hear so many of, especially with the internet. There's people that just see it in print and they go, well, I can read this and I can also make sense of it, so it must be true. Well, you know, and it's just fantasy, you know. Oh, one of the things that was going around lately, what was it? Oh, of course, it's about Paul. Paul being a heretic. Oh, boy, you know. And that's, of course, the seminar that we had to deal with. Some people still don't get that, you know, and we need to pray for them and, you know, encourage them and not get angry. It's easy to do, but you need to just say, well, don't, you know, people are struggling with all these false doctrines, you know.
Do you think there will be a new heaven and a new earth when he says he's going to destroy what's here now? Do you reckon that there will be a new heaven and a new earth, or he will just sort of restore it? Do you think he'll just replace it all? Or?
Well, I think that his creation is right now, it has a curse on it, and that curse will be lifted. But as we understand things, the reality of the world, you know, the second law of thermodynamics, which I've mentioned before, ooh, and the chaos and all that, that's going to be healed. You know, the fruit, the land will be burned clean, and it's going to be a thorough cleansing of all man's works, you know, all these old steeples and towers and obelisks and all the witchery will be just completely removed from the earth. And the renewal of the earth is what we're really talking about. The renewal is what's going to happen. What we have here is, I think, a misunderstanding of the words. But, you know, if he wants to do something else, and just wipe everything out. Well, he seems in many scriptures to indicate that that everything is permanent. And he says if ever these things ever disappear, then Israel shall also disappear. Well, that's not going to happen. You know, the permanence he's described to the universe and the stars and the sun and the moon. These are all permanent fixtures. But they will be renewed. And that word renewed and the word new in the Hebrew, kadash, or, you know, some people spell it kodesh, is a word that can be taken to be new, completely new. But when we talk about a new moon, it's not like a different moon. Like, what? There's another moon coming up. What do you think that is? Well, it's just a renewal of the moon. It's the same moon, but it's being renewed. And that's what, I think that's what it really is. But we still can't get in arguments over things like that. That's silly, you know. Because, you know. But that, you know, that the last chapter of his book, is that where these things are being summed up?
Yeah, most of them, yeah. In this last chapter. He also says that he goes into detail about Elijah or Eliyahu, and he says that he was like a breaker, like the sheep, there's always a breaker that, that goes forth so all the others will follow him. And he said that whenever there's something about you should expect Elijah and then you should expect a king. So that's why when John the Baptist was immersing everybody and the Pharisees were grilling him about it, who are you, he wouldn't say who he was. But Yahushua came along and said he's coming, something about he's come in the spirit of Elijah. And Todd's gone, aha, so you can expect the breaker and then there's the king. And so he goes on about that, like that he was preparing the way for the king. And yeah. Something about a prophecy then about bringing the hearts of the fathers to the children and the hearts of the children to the fathers. Only half of that has been fulfilled, he's saying, because the spirit of Eliyahu with Yohanan, the immerser, he came and led the way and brought the hearts of the father to the children, but the reverse has not yet happened. So he's saying that before you expect Yahushua again, you should expect Elijah, not the spirit of Elijah. You should expect Elijah, something like that, and that he will bring the hearts of the children to their fathers, which is the tribes of Israel, back the hearts back to the something like that.
Yeah, the children that's being referred to are the descendants of of Yisrael. Yeah. That's exactly right. People misunderstand. They when they see the word children, they think of little people. But he's not talking about that necessarily, but certainly including them. But like I'm a child, you're a child, we're all children, and we're heirs, but we're not to be proud of, we shouldn't think of ourselves as being deserving as heirs, but we should be thinking in a humility of being an heir and saying, well, I'm undeserving of this, and why has this happened to me? And all of us remember the former mind of the flesh that we used to live in, and we used to serve the flesh, and everything was about how much you could get, but it's a matter of, we seek education in order to get more money and all that. That's not what the goal is, it's to teach your children, the Torah. And that's the best thing that you can probably do in this world, is to teach your children the Torah. And then also teach others. Your first job, of course, is to teach your children. And that's where Israel, and I'm not talking about just the state of Israel or, the kingdom of Israel or northern Israel, southern Israel. I'm talking about Israel as the 12 tribes, they're like priests to the nations. And they failed to teach the nations the Torah. And that's what the whole goal was. They were the least of the nations, but they were chosen, not because they were better, but because they were chosen for a task. And they failed so far to succeed in that. But now with the Messiah's head put back on the body, so the body includes Yahushua. He's guiding his body to do the work. And that's what the Nazarene are all about. See, we're plugged into the head. And the parts of the body are doing his work as he's directing it. So we can't go to the left arm and go, what's that left arm doing over there? What? That's not right. Keep your mind off that. Look to the head. And he's doing things all over the place. In different ways, but the task is getting done now, and we can expect like Yahushua and the Immerser, or Eliyahu, or any of the other prophets, that when you start doing his work, the enemy is at work focusing on pounding you into dust. So we can wherever the dust is, wherever the attack is, that's where the biggest part of the work's being done. We're like a cutting blade in a cave. We're mining out the precious gold and silver, but there's going to be a lot of dust, and the enemy is coming in to attack. So if you see somebody that's just not getting any attacks, then you can assume that, well, the enemy's not concerned about them. But if you've got somebody that's like everything's like, oh, that's evil. Well, the Torah is not evil, you know, but the workers of the harvest, they're working in the dirt of the world, the soil, you know, and the dirtiest part of the world, and that's where the precious seed is planted, and then it produces the fruit that we desire, or he desires. And of course, we can't look back and go, well, how's that doing back there? You know, we just plant the seed and keep, and others water it, you know, with the guidance of the Spirit of Yahushua. And he waters it, and he allows it to grow. And over time, there's going to be a great harvest. And the harvest is what this festival of Sukkot is all about. And the harvest points to the Torah, because the Torah is the goal. It's the goal. The Torah is the thing that produces the seed. In fact, it is the seed, the mind of Messiah. And when you understand the Torah is the thought, the very thoughts and personality of the Messiah, of the Creator, then you go, well, wait a minute. If that's the way he thinks, I want to think like that, you know. And you reprogram yourself and renew your heart and renew your mind, and then suddenly you're different from everyone else. And you want them to see the light, you know, as we say, before they take the big sleep. The next seminar is going to be on the big sleep, you know, the death of the last enemy. Death, the last enemy.
Wonderful.
You know, it's going to be fun. I'm learning a lot. See, I study, and then I just, you know, I let him teach me first, and then I just bring that out, and he guides me into these little things. And then it somehow fits together and locks into this idea. But no one has ever been able to say, I've been dead, and let me tell you all about it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Well, you know, no, we haven't got that report yet.
Yeah.
So even as much, you could spend your whole life studying the topic of death and know nothing.
It's like
this big black veil, and you go, well, let me imagine what's behind this veil. And that's all you could do, you know. But he has revealed a lot about death in the scriptures. And, you know, that's where I'm digging at, you know, so because that's pure truth. But it is a mystifying thing.
So do you, when you're looking up, say, death, would you look up every reference to the word death, or would you specific, or just, I know you're letting you, who should guide you, but would you, how would you tackle a subject like that?
That's something that I don't know, have any clue about. I just say, well, certainly you would do a concordance, or, you know, you look up the word death and see where that comes, pops out, but he's going to lead you. It's amazing. It's always been this way, but I'll be reading various things like secular magazines, the scriptures. I'll read articles both on the internet and magazines. And then suddenly this thing just keeps popping out at you, the topic itself. It's like he's bringing it. He brings things to people, like he fed Eliyahu with ravens. You know, he just brings the food, you know, the data to you. And you just have to just say, what? And I'm writing it down. You're writing it down in the middle of the night. So I woke up last night. And the night before, and the night before that, just writing down things. Where is that coming from? I don't know, you know. But it's all just intended to be disseminated into the body, so that the bride knows things, you know. Because the revelation comes from, you know, the teachers, and the teachers disseminate that knowledge. And quite often, there'll be several teachers that suddenly he comes into and starts speaking the same thing to all at once. I've seen that happen so many times. It's amazing. We've got some kind of a, like we call in the, you know, in the Star Trek thing with the Borg, a hive mind, you know, because he's controlling our minds, and it's just so amazing to watch. And I just rejoice. I don't think, at one time I was thinking, It entered my mind because I was, you know, we're still in a battle with our flesh. I was thinking, hey, he's not supposed to know that. And I'm going, wait a minute. That's great that he knows that. And some other teacher will be saying the same thing. And it's because Yahushua's speaking, you know. I'm just rejoicing about that because it's not about us. It's not about us at all.
Wow. Do you think after the seventh day is over, that the eighth day, or that's what this day represents, the beginning of the new cycle, if you want to call it, you reckon it'll go into another cycle,
You mean another week, the 1,000-year days?
Yeah.
And when 7,000 years is done. Yeah. Well, we're going to have that 7,000 years where we'll be resting from the attacks of the dragon. The dragon will be bound. Well, first, the beast of the false prophet will be thrown into the lake of fire first. The first one in there. So at that point, the beast and the false prophet are thrown into the lake of fire. And they're in there, in the lake of fire, destroyed. You know, so they're taken out first. So no one's in the lake of fire yet. I mean, how could they be? You know.
So the lake of fire represents total destruction.
Annihilation. Total unbelievable. Let's see, what is it? The prophet Obadiah, or Obadiah, he talks about that. It's as if they never existed. You know, I don't know what the chapter is. I think it's 16, but I have to look. Obadiah mentions that. Anyway, the idea of annihilation isn't so bad. I mean, isn't such a heresy. But if you want to just torture somebody forever and ever and ever and ever and ever, in your mind, I mean, that's fine. But I don't like the idea of that. But if that's the case, if Yahushua wants to do that, he's the king. We don't have to worry. But like I say, we know him, and we don't have to know. If we know the one that knows, it's his department. We can't say, well, you know, he doesn't believe in eternal torment. Run away from him. Well, others that do, I don't run away from them. But I believe the beast and the false prophet come to their end. And then the dragon is bound and his fallen ones for 1,000 years. And then they're released at the end of that for a short time, very short. And then they're destroyed, you know. And it is, and the smoke of their torment rises forever and ever. It doesn't say their torment rises forever, but their smoke of it does as an eternal reminder of what happened, you know. But then the new day, the new week, you say. Well, yes, the eighth day. Well, there is no eighth day. It's like we studied in the heartbeat of creation, that it, the octave of the musical letter C is just vibrating at twice the frequency. So it's the beginning of a new scale. And it's a new week. So it's not an eighth day, but it would be the first day of another week. And I suppose that he would have, he hasn't revealed anything about that. But it would probably be true that he's going to stay with a pattern. And the week of creation is a small picture or miniature model of the grand scheme. So that's his department also. So I'd have to defer to Yahushua, you know. If he wants to reveal something beforehand, that's fine.
So when you were saying back when we were doing the Day of Yahuwah, Doco, that there will be a small portion of mankind that manages to escape the fire and make it into the seventh day. The main question is, if they're not being pestered, most of people's resistance to Torah, we always thought was because they're being kept away by evil, I guess. If evil's changed, why wouldn't they want Torah? What do you think? It might be the nature of their heart still to resist it.
Well, we still have a fallen world. It's not completely renewed yet at that point, because the fallen nature is apparently still active. Otherwise, there would be no rebellion at that point. But like when the day was when Noah and his seven other family members came through the flood, as we understand it, that was all there was, and that this small number was all that made it through, and they produced all that we see now in the world of human beings. And in a similar way, the precious quantity, the number of people that will make it through the Great Tribulation, will be very, very few. We don't know a number, but we do know that it's going to be very few, and they're going to be as rare as fine gold, as the gold of Ophir. there's going to be a very small number. And that from that number will be a great increase. And it even speaks of them having longer ages. They'll live longer lifespans. But from that group, not all of them, but from that group will come those who are rebellious, and they'll not want to, you know, obey because of their nature. And probably the fact that just being, you know, prone to the same kinds of thoughts of the mind of the flesh, you know, the lust of the eyes and the pride of life and those sorts of things. When we try to get above others and rank ourselves, you know, the pride of life has to do with being better than other people, you know, ranking yourself in your own heart and mind. And when you look at other people and you say, I'm better than them, they can't even talk, or I'm better than them because I look better, or I'm better than them because I believe the right things, whatever the reason is, these are the things that cause these kind of things to manifest themselves. And then they take after themselves groups of people to follow them. And that's probably where the rebellion is at, because this pride thing is where Hashatan, the evil leader of the fallen Malachi, that's where it all started in his heart. I mean, he was in, you know, he was number two. Now, Yahuwah was number one, and he was the covering Malachim. He was the one that was closest to Yahuwah, the most beautiful creature in all creation, the most intellectual, the most knowledgeable, the one that was probably the most loved. And all of this together was just overwhelming to him. And then he became jealous of what he saw in Yahuwah and wanted to be like Yahuwah and take all the attention to himself from all the other created creatures, you know. And that's where the key of the fall really happened. When he fell, it was because he wanted the attention that was given to Yahuwah. We need to take our focus and get it off of ourselves, if we're leaders, and put it to Yahuwah. Put it back to Yahusha, because he's the one that we're pointing to always. You know, our joy comes from him, not from any knowledge that we have or any possessions that we have or any of that, because our treasure is in him. And the fact that we know him and the fact that our names are written in the scroll of life, all of these things point to Yahusha. And we're going to throw our crowns that he gives us at his feet, you know, and we're nothing, you know, that's the thing. And you know what I really liked when I saw that video that you just produced, was what was in your heart. You knew it was in your heart all those years, that you're striving to be an achiever and to seek fame for yourself. Was it came to an end when you found the truth, and you saw the precious need to get other people away from that sort of mindset. And that's the mind of the flesh. It's the very thing, the pride of life, that's where we fail. We can still fail. We have to be very careful and pray diligently to Yahusha to clean our hearts every day, to find what's wrong in our hearts and keep purging us.
Just to go back a bit, do you think Hashatan fell in between the first two verses of Genesis 1? You know, when it says, in the beginning Yahuwah created the heavens and the earth. And then the next verse he says the earth was without form and void. So others have then said, well, why would he create something that's without form and void? Maybe that's when Lucifer fell and there was a big catastrophe. Or do you go along with that? Or?
Well, I understand it totally, and I don't agree with it, but I can certainly see it. And I'm not saying that the people are necessarily wrong that believe that, but it's not written down as an instruction for us to understand. It's not there. We're imagining that. That's like, well, let's take this to a hypothetical level and assume that this is when it happened. But I don't think that we need to do those sorts of things, because then we're bringing what we call eisegesis to our study. You know, eisegesis and exegesis are two approaches to the study. When we bring things to the study that are not there, then we read things into the word. But if we just look at what it says and just cling to what that says and not add or take away, then we're going to be on the right track. So, and what produces a lot of the outcomes from these false readings when you read things in is division. And that's the very goal that the adversary has, is divide us up in as many little pieces as he can, so that teamwork is not possible. And we're not under the headship of Yahusha, but we're under the headship of all these other little people. And then, and their eyes are not on Yahusha. They're looking at, hey, who are you trying to control over there? Oh, no, I'm losing people. Don't worry about that. Get people to look to Yahusha. You know, and then the adversary can't get you divided up. You know, you're not using the letter W. What? The letter W? Well, throw him away. You know, what is that about? You know,
disgusting.
You're disgusting. You use that letter U. Okay. What's up with that? Anyway, there's all kinds of reasons for us to get upset. I'm not upset about people that are using the letter W. I'm just saying, let's just find out what the truth is, and let's look to Yahusha and not worry about all this, you know, division, you know.
Yeah. At one point the other night in Todd's book, he says about the two witnesses, I think he used prophesying for 3.5 years, I think it was. Do you think that's, I mean, from what you stated in your two witnesses study, you think it will probably be on that level anyway. It'll be Eliyahu and Moshe. Do you think the 3.5 years is 3.5 years?
Oh, yes. I think the 3.5 years are found in Scripture in a number of places. One of the things that occurs in the book of Daniel is that the 70 weeks is prophesied, and the last week is actually divided up into two parts, and the Messiah is the one that ended the sacrifices 3.5 years after his ministry started. His ministry would have started in during the Feast of Tabernacles or Sukkoth. That's when his ministry started, and 3.5 years later it ended at Passover, and that's when the sacrifices ended. Now the other 3.5 years that is ahead of us is a tribulation period. And the Jacob's trouble, as they call it, Yaakov's trouble, and that would be, you know, the final 3.5 years. So the 3.5 years is not continuous. It's 7 years. The 7 years is divided up, and it came to an end, and it's like it's put on hold right now. So right now, we have to wait for it to start up. And some people have said that the 3.5 years will be, the last 3.5 years will be reinitiated when the false prophet sets himself up in the temple in the city of Jerusalem, proclaiming himself to be Elohim. And that's going to be something that we will see, but the world will not see. And then at the end of that 3.5 years, Yahusha returns, and the final Yom Teruah will occur, the raising of the dead first, and then we who are yet alive will be changed. So that 3.5 years is, as far as I can tell, still ahead. But some people have said that it's going to be a false prophet that's going to arise and set himself up and proclaim himself to be Elohim in the temple. And, of course, it could be a rebuilt temple, or it could be his fortresses that he builds. The fortresses of the papacy, for example, if they ever move from Rome to Jerusalem and the fortresses are built up there, then we can assume that that is the beginning.
So do you think that false prophet setting himself up, do you think that would be someone along the lines of a political dictator, or do you think it'll be somebody like who wants to deceive people, like if he came back and said, I'm on JESUS, you know, and started doing miracles, and what do you think it would be along that line?
Well, I think it would be more or less the fact that the papacy fits all of those bills in the sense that it is a position, an office of both spiritual and material reign. That's why the Pope raises up two fingers. He's raising those two fingers to signify that he has complete political authority over the earth as well as spiritual authority. And that, of course, is the shape on the hand of the statue of the Roman deity as well. And that's what the fascist is a symbol of, too. It's a bundling of the authority. But it all focuses itself in this hand symbol. Now, if somebody photographs me doing this and they send it around the internet, you're naughty. It's all basically the papacy does fit the bill. Where else is it going to come from? I mean, you know, is it going to be a Ahmadinejad type person that says I'm the last imam or whatever, or the next imam? It could be that, but it'll be a spiritual and physical political ruler. Because see, the Pope is a king. He's a ruler of a period of a section of the world. You know, in the hearts of people, he's a spiritual ruler, but in the he's actually got an embassy in many countries, you know, so he is a political and spiritual leader. And, of course, the dragon moved there, apparently, if it's symbolized by the obelisk, then the dragon moved from Egypt, Alexandria specifically, to Rome in the first century. And it wasn't the Nazarene that did that. It was the pagans. We brought that out in the seminar on the image of the beast.
Yeah.
So, yeah, the biggest obelisk in the world right now seems to be in Washington, D.C., which is also patterned after the Roman thing. I mean, they've got a thing called a Senate, you know. They've got this dome building. It's, in fact, many dome buildings. They have the statue of Liberty, which is a Roman deity. It's up on the top of the Capitol building. It's a very little statue, but it's several feet high. But it's up there on the top of this dome. And when the founding fathers built this thing, they actually called the Capitol the temple of the deity Liberty, a Roman deity. So you know, it's basically when the Islamists say that United States is the great Satan, they're right, you know, and that's where his throne is. His throne is moved around the earth over the millennia, but right now, that's where it is. Washington, D.C. is right now the place where the most money is being made. And in fact, it's the reason for that is because government workers make anywhere from 50 to 60 to 80% more than the private sector makes. And that's where all the real wealth is now, is in government jobs. And they want to make more of them. In fact, the pharaoh right now, I'm calling him the pharaoh of this country, is running around right now saying, we need this jobs bill. Well, the jobs bill isn't about private sector jobs. It's about public sector jobs. And the people are not even aware of that. You know, they're just, the word's not getting out. So anyway, this whole thing is like, it's pivoting on this one place, this place that they call Washington, D.C. right now, I'm sad to say. But if it ever moves to, well, the authority of Rome is really residing in this place. So when you read the book of Daniel and you read like chapter 7 and you read chapter 9 and you see and you read this thing as the beast, you know, the beast is, of course, a religious political authority, you know, and it's a model, you know. It's not so much a physical place. It's a model, you know. And that's what really the scriptures is talking about. And when that model moves itself to center itself through the power of the United Nations into Jerusalem, then we can start counting the clock again. We've got the final 3.5 years going.
Okay.
You know, okay. I mean, why not?
That's the thing.
Wow.
Yeah.
I mean, why not? Why we can at least watch for that. You know, I'm not saying that that we have to set anything in concrete yet, but we could at least consider that, you know, as a possibility. In fact, a very likely possibility.
Because I know you've stated the two witnesses were on many levels. you know, they could be the Torah, the two tablets of the Torah. It could be the, you know, us, we're all witnesses, over the 3,500 years that were since the Torah was given, that sort of. Do you think there will be two men walking around, and in this day and age it'd be broadcast because of the way it is? Do you think there'll be two men that walk around and start speaking Torah?
I tend to believe that there will be literally two men, and then there will be also figurative levels of interpretation too, where we will be operating in the world as two witnesses, and we'll be whatever.
The two tribes of Israel, yeah. Mm-hmm. Coming together.
Whatever weapons are used against us, the fire that comes out of our mouth will be Torah, and it will destroy our enemies' mindsets. Whatever it is that their logic comes up with, the fire of Torah will burn it up, you know, and consume the enemies. So I don't expect that we'll all be literally seeing fire coming out of our mouth and destroying people, but it could be that if there are two physical men that do this, that they would probably be Moshe and Eliyahu, because they're, you know, the things that they represent. Moshe represents the Torah, and Eliyahu represents the fact that he's a witness that Yahuwah is Elohim, not the moon deity or the earth, like Al Gore would like to explain. I don't mean to tear up on Al Gore, but Al Gore has mentioned the Earth Mother by name. G-A-I-A, you know. Yeah. In fact, just yesterday, two men came in to the shop, you know, the shop, and they were saying, we're here to get you to support this idea. And they had this binder with all this green on it, you know. And I'm going, Joseph Stalin, environmentalism, promote socialism through environmentalism. See, Joseph Stalin's the one that said that. Anyway, they wanted to talk to me about carbon dioxide. And I said, you know, you're breathing oxygen, don't you? Well, where did that oxygen come from? And I said, carbon dioxide. It came, if you didn't have carbon dioxide, you wouldn't have oxygen, because that's where it comes from. Carbon turns into wood, and the oxygen is dioxide, and then one of the oxygen levels is given to you to breathe. It comes out of all plants. So it's a design, and if you had high levels, if you had 50% carbon dioxide, it wouldn't even compete with the water vapor that's causing the earth to warm up. And that warming is good, because warming means you're not frozen solid. And if without carbon dioxide, it really wouldn't matter. The water vapor would do all the work. But the carbon dioxide, even if it was 50%, what would happen is the plants would just suck it up like candy, and in a matter of 2 or 3 days, it would be back to normal levels. And the wood would be awesome. All this wood would appear. You know, it would just be amazing. And then the oxygen levels would just jump way up. In fact, we'd have to worry about lighting a match. Look at it. That's high oxygen levels out there, you know. And actually, in the ancient world, looking at tree sap, they have determined from the bubbles that were trapped in the tree sap that there was much higher levels of oxygen in 3,000-4,000 years ago. So we have evidence that the oxygen levels have been dropping, and that in itself is causing a lot of cancer. Not only the toxins, but the fact that oxygen levels are dropping, especially in the urban areas. So, and if you've got a furnace, and you're using the inside oxygen to burn the furnace, then you're depleting the inside oxygen levels massively in your house. And a lot of cancer occurs in homes, in families, that have depleted oxygen levels, you know. So you need to move further south where you use less furnaces. And get a better furnace, too, you know, when it's efficient. Well, we've really segued into a lot of things, but what were we on? Where did we start out?
We started out at Simchat Torah, the New Jerusalem coming down. But it's okay. All part and parcel.
Yeah. Well, anyway, there's a lot of misdirection and misinformation out there, you know. And we're so also busy that it's hard for somebody to really study Scripture and hold down the two jobs that they have. I have two jobs. I've got a secular job, and of course I bemoan that every day with Phyllis. I go, oh no, I have to go over to that shop. But you know, it's to support this work, and then the work that I do for Yahusha, I put in many more hours, you know. But it's all for joy, you know. But I do run into people at the shop, and I see why I have to be there, because the people that walk in, you know, just about every day, there's somebody that walks in. In fact, several times, some days, and you know, it's just a wonderful thing to be able to serve him in all these different ways. So anyway, what else is in that book? That book sounds like a treasure trove.
Oh, it's totally amazing. It's taken most of this year to get through it. And interestingly now, we're putting an ad in the paper up north. They're going to advertise, the next book they're going through is Fossilized Customs. And there's about six of us that are going to do a chapter each week, and they're putting it in the paper. So anybody who, and they're stating, you know, this is a controversial book. The author is getting attacked, and friends and everybody's just up in arms about this book. And you're welcome to come along and hear it read, and putting it out in the paper. So we're going to use the idea too and do one down here in Sydney. So we thought, why try and come up with something original when it's all written down? You know, you've done all the work.
So I'll be able to be hated on several continents now. That's great.
Yeah.
Well, praise you for that. That's wonderful. And I'm going to get an even hotter water. But anyway, the thing that is amazing, though, is the people that attack Yahusha, not that I would put myself in that league, but I'm just saying the same sorts of things that happen to his followers happened to him, you know, first. And the religious people were the ones that were mostly upset with him because of the message that he carried. And the same thing is true of the descendants of his message, the branches, the Nazarene. So when we're out disseminating the same things that he was doing, then we're attacked by the religious people.
Interestingly, when we first came across Fossilized Customs and the assembly we were in at the time was having a bit of a violent reaction to it, and so about eight of us just decided to disappear because that's how we dealt with it. My father, sorry.
What disappeared?
We did.
Oh.
From the assembly. We thought there's just too much friction going on here where we're out of here.
You mean Max, right? Max?
Yeah, yeah. And so Chris. Sorry.
Every day. I pray for Max every day.
Yeah, well, he's...
I want to mention this. Keep your thought, but I wanted to mention that the Tigert family just lost their daughter, Sophia, so everyone pray for them. And, you know, precious in the sight of Yahuwah is the death of his saints. So
yes.
You have to hold to that. But what were you going to say about Max?
I was going to say that they sort of weren't... They're more into it now. They're spreading the name of... what they say, Yeshua, they're spreading that around Indonesia. But my father and mother, mainly my father, who was in the assembly with us, he when this all happened, he couldn't go along with the fact that it was a different Messiah, in a sense. He wrote to all these top evangelists and apostles, that they call themselves in Christianity, and basically dobbed on you because of your book. And it's not hard to type in your name in the internet and hear all sorts of sordid, you know, stories. Oh. So, and I said to him, Dad, you only wrote to Christians. How are you going to get a fully rounded understanding of a book that's not a Christian book from getting all these responses from Christians? But what he got back from most of them was, oh, there's the majority of that book is true, yes, but a lot of it is not. And so he's saying it's not true. I'm thinking, they just said that the majority of it is true, but they're not doing it, you know, which was amazing to me.
Well, you know, one of the things that happened to me is you get a shift of your own perspective when you deal with the truth, because it knocks you off of your perspective. And one of the things that really put me into this proper perspective was imagining the assembly that I attended before. If Yahushua himself walked up from the stage and just stood behind the pulpit and started to tell us the truth, most of the people in the room would get up and leave because they wouldn't want to hear the truth. And it would be Yahushua himself. And I realized that. And that was really a profound mental image that I had in my mind. And I put Yahushua's presence in front of the person that was doing the speaking. And I was going, now Yahushua would not say what I just heard him say. You know, because they say one thing and then less than 30 seconds later they'll say the opposite. You know, and I'm going, wait a minute, he just said this, and then he said something a few seconds later that was the opposite. You know, and Yahushua doesn't do that, you know. And that was the point where I had to not go back. You know, and I thought, well, there's not really any way I can stand up and go, excuse me, but you just contradicted yourself. You know, and that's the mind of the flesh and not having the spirit, all those things, you know. But the masquerading messengers are out there, and they're the vast majority. Yeah. Not that we need to hate them, but we have to understand that they're the ones that have the real power, that it's given to them by the dragon.
Yeah.
We're the weak little flock, you know.
Yeah.
But and we still love them, you know.
Yeah.
But anyway, how did your dad deal with all this? And
He's still sort of distanced himself from it. He went back into Christianity full swing, and with my brother-in-law, and same church, the same circus as my brother-in-law, and all that sort of thing. My brother-in-law's an associate pastor and all that sort of thing. So a lot of the way we handled it back then, they're angry at that too, because we sort of just disappeared and went up north, and sort of, you know, we spoke out about things, and we weren't very gentle about it. And despite all the things they said and did, it was, you know, it didn't go down well. So we're smoothing it over all the time.
Good. Because, you know, as we get moderated and our zeal is like toned a little bit, and, you know, it's a matter of letting Yahushua just deal with one issue at a time instead of just blasting them. You know, it just blinds them. They can't handle all that. Neither could we. You know, we can just take one page of Fossilized Customs at a time, you know. don't blind. You know, the scriptures is a record of rebellion, well, creation, and then rebellion, and then of course the plan of salvation. You know, and it's all about love. You know, and so we can miss that if we go out and we say no, it's about knowledge. You know, it isn't about knowledge. It's about understanding the love Yahuwah has for us. So John 3:16, 17, 18, you know, those are all very important texts. And we have to remember that he loved us when we were yet sinners. And we have to remember that the people that are a little off the mark right now, they still are covered by the blood, but we just need to guide them and refine them and, you know, perfect the bride, get the wrinkles out, you know. Don't be afraid of that. You know. Don't be afraid of it. Don't defend the fact that it's a Greek word and say, well, I only want to talk Greek. You know, why do you want to do that? You know, because the apostles spoke Greek. In the first century, it was very unlikely the apostles knew very many Greek words at all. Shaul or Paul did. But he was, you know, admitting that. You know, that was what made him distinct. But he was also greatly used because of his capabilities to speak Greek. And that was preparing him for being lashed to two Roman soldiers so that he could speak to them, you know, in a perfect accent. Because, you know, we have to speak to this people in babbling tongue, you know. See, our tongue is babbling right now. And Yahuwah is
some more than others.
Yeah. But we need to stop the babbling and restore the pure lip, you know, not us, but, you know, Yahusha. And we have to love the real name. You know, you can't just say, well, no, I like this fake name that I grew to love first. You know, we have to overcome that. And it was a painful thing for me, too. When I found out that his name was not J-E-S-U-S, I was going, well, maybe I could hang on to both of them. And I hung on to both of them for, oh, not long, though. Some people do longer than others. But, you know,
it's heartbreaking, isn't it?
One of these is a lie. Which one is it? You know?
We tried to alter all our Christian songs and change the names in them because we still wanted to keep the same songs. But we just changed the names. But after a while, when you leave completely, you just want to scrap all the songs, and, you know. So I went around and started writing new songs completely. But now we don't sort of use many of the songs when we have a meeting. It's more just about the word, like you would in your seminars. It's not much music.
I was listening to Amy singing We Are Witnesses, and it just brings tears to my eyes, you know, just the power in the words, you know, and her voice, you know. It's like she's the bride singing to the husband. It's just so amazing, you know. You all ought to look that up on YouTube and look at the songs and look for We Are Witnesses and so many other songs that are just beautiful.
Yeah.
You guys are amazing.
I have to get her to record some more songs. It's very different when she records them.
And you have a new daughter, a new name for your daughter.
Yes.
Aaliyah.
Aaliyah, yes.
Bless Aaliyah. And, you know, that's wonderful. That's a beautiful name. You want to tell people what it means?
It means Yahuwah is Elohim.
Yes, Aaliyah.
Which these days people need to know.
I mean, listen to that word, Aaliyah. Wow. You know, I was listening to the radio yesterday, and the speaker on the radio was talking about the lady that married Ahab. You remember the witch? The super witch.
Yeah.
They spell her name J-E-Z-E-B-E-L. Anyway, that's the way they spell her name. But he said, who would name their daughter that? You know?
And, I would.
You would? No, not my, but not. I mean, you were misled by the internet. The internet said it meant something different.
Yeah.
But a lot of times those meanings and those dictionaries for children's names, they're not quite true.
Yeah.
They don't go back far enough. Hmm. Yeah. But anyway, it's such a great day. I love that name.
So we're still correcting ourselves. The boys have got it. I think I'm the slowest one. I still call her the old one, and I get corrected all the time. Just putting it into the computer.
Well, that's a wonderful thing that you have a heart that can be corrected, you know. And you know, if there's anything that's evil in our hearts, we need to just let him just come in and clean that out, and then we'll be clean on the outside. See, and that's the good thing. We'll still be working in the mud, you know, the world, and you know, while he's working with us. But I know I'm certainly working in the mud, but. You know, those people don't want to hear it. The Torah-phobic people, you know. Let's see what these guys are showing us. Oh, yeah. Remember them? The Nairobi Trio.
Yes.
They're all over the place now, you know.
I'm going to have to start putting some cool things on my desk here so I can do show and tell as well.
I've got all kinds of fun things that I play with, you know.
Oh.
Yeah. Anyway, I don't know if you might not want that, but anyway, I just love to have fun, you know.
Yeah.
You know, Yahusha is he's got a sense of humor too, you know.
You have to.
Well, I have. Yes. Well, we're not through. Do you want to see the lovely? You want to say hi to Phyllis?
Are we in trouble again?
Look at this. No. I just imagine the New Jerusalem.
Oh.
What? Beautiful.
Oh, that's beautiful. Well, thanks. I just wanted to say hi to everybody.
Yeah, get down.
Oh, I'm sorry.
There you are.
Now, I wanted to say hi to everybody.
Yeah.
All right. There you go. Hi, Mark. How you doing?
Good. It was suggested to me today. No, stay, sister, stay. It was suggested to me today that if we wanted to do a different feel for a couple of these shows, we should invite Amy in and invite Phyllis in. I'd have to cram us into the shot, but...
Right.
Could have an interesting little chitter chat.
Okay. That'll be fun.
Yeah.
You can see how big my head is compared to hers.
It's all beard, mate. It's all beard.
Oh, man. I got the big head. Anyway, isn't that great? She's the love of my life and just an amazing person. She gets me up every morning, you know. Well.
Working alarm clock.
Yeah. Well, she doesn't even usually set the alarm. She just wakes up, you know. Yeah. And when a certain point comes, and she just wakes up, you know.
Yeah. So the joy of Torah, the joy of Yahusha.
Yeah, Torah. Yeah, when we're talking about Torah, we're talking about Yahusha. Yeah. Mm-hmm. His mind, his personality, his, his character, you know. It's. I was just sitting with the grandchildren this morning around the table as they were, you know, sitting around, and I said, you know, the first commandment and the second commandment, you know, we were talking about the Torah. I said, you know, we're to speak of the Torah when we rise up. And that's when I give them the thing in little small bites. And they're still young. They're all under 10 years old. But, you know, it was a good thing to be able to share that with them and remind them what today was, you know, Simchat Torah, the joy of Torah. The joy that comes into our hearts when the Messiah first comes into us. It's like, what? I love these commandments. Why do I love your instructions? You know, because I want to love your instructions. And he made your heart change. And it's a choice. It's just like everything in life. It's a choice. You decide. It's a decision that you make. And that's what the problem is with the other people that don't want to have anything to do with the covenant. They think that it's Jewish or something, or they're Christians and they're in that mindset, and they will not submit to the covenant, you know. But if they just say, you know, let me just try it. Once they've tasted it, there is no going back and saying, you know, I just want to get back into that Christmas tree thing again, even though it makes me mad. Once your eyes, you're knocked off of your frame of reference and you see it from his point of view instead of yours, that's all it takes. And you say, wow, this is a great thing. I like seeing things from his point of view instead of mine. That's the difference between the mind of the flesh and the mind of the spirit, because you're looking at it from his point of view. And then he comes in and says, now everything you see is from my perspective. And that's all it is, you know. It's pure and simple.
Wow.
Not pure and complicated.
No.
And you can't do this yourself. You know, you can't just say, well, if I just live strictly according to these things, then everything will work out. But it isn't like that. You don't have to do that. He does it all for you, you know. Because you see it his way, you know.
It was really encouraging about a month ago or so when you said that having a love for the Torah, and I said to you, how do you find the discipline to get there all the time? And you said, I'm constantly trying to get there. You know, life is just life, and you're just constantly trying to get to the Torah. That encouraged me, because I think most of us are in that boat, but we love it. And so instead of being, because there's a scripture that says there's no condemnation for those who are in you, instead of feeling like you're a dog and you're nothing and, I didn't read Torah today. I'm not, you know, I'm a heathen. I'm a this, I'm a that. I think you go beyond that and you think, yeah, I'm getting there. I'm where I'm at. I can see other people that seem further down the road than me, but you get fed up with the depression. I think the depression of yourself is the opposite to the joy of Torah, isn't it?
Yeah, when you look at yourself, you do see a bad, ugly thing. But when you take your mind off of that, look at Yahusha, and then realize that he loves you, and that gives you, you know, it gives you value, because if he loves you, even though you don't value yourself, which is good, I mean, you don't want to be prideful, but when you realize how much he loves you, then it gives you hope, you know, and a desire to please him, you know. And when people see us obeying a commandment or an instruction, then, and they feel intimidated, because they don't want to, or they don't feel like they can, or that they're not Jews or something. You know, they have a lot of reasons. But, you know, when they do that sort of thing and they think that we're judging them because we live differently, like our families. You know, our families see us obeying the Sabbath and using the correct name, the Hebrew name, or anything. Then you won't eat swine flesh. My mother one time put a bowl of bean soup that she had lovingly made in front of me. And I was going through it, and I was going, Mom, what's this? It looks like some kind of meat. And she said, oh, that's ham. And I, you know, the whole thing's defiled. You know, I didn't want to break her heart, but I couldn't eat it. You know, I said, well, Mom, I don't eat ham. You know, I'm so sorry. You know, and, you know, that makes them feel terrible, you know, because they think that you're better than them. And that's not the message at all. You know, but it's a matter of looking at everything from his perspective, you know. And then practicing it and saying, well, I'm going to give this up because I can't do that. Because it displeases, you know, Yahuwah. It's like Yosef when he was in Mitzrayim and he was being seduced by another man's wife. This is an abomination. I will not do this and defile myself before the eyes of my maker. I will not do this. This is evil, you know. And he ran away, you know. And he had to, probably had to do it many times. And the final time, you know, he got caught, but because he was naked. There were other witnesses probably. But the fact that he would not do something, that might be my email. That's probably what that is. And there was an email coming splashing in. Anyway, the thing of it is, we have to decide who we're going to serve. And if we're going to submit to human traditions and say, well, he won't mind if I do this, if I don't think of it that way, or it doesn't mean that to me, you know. Well, what does it mean to him, you know? If I just go out and I buy a big obelisk, or put up a tree, you know, or get a pumpkin and carve it out and put it on my front porch. You know, these are abominations. You know, they're practices of the heathen, you know. And he doesn't want his children learning the ways of the heathen, you know. Deuteronomy chapter 12, you know, if they read that. And then program your mind with the Torah, you know.
Wow. Well,
yeah.
I like the new song. New song lyrics you sent through.
Oh, the lyrics. Yeah, that's going to be problematic, I think, because it's... well, you play guitar really well, so you can probably make it sound...
I don't know if I can go there. I might get Amy to come in and help me, and we might turn it into a symphony or something like that.
Okay. The original song itself, the lyrics are just, I think, atrocious. But if we put the pure words in, and the song itself has a good, you know, pounding pomposity to it. You know, I kind of like the energy level of it, you know, because it is somewhat about the day we're born. I kind of kept that aspect of it. The day that we're born, we're actually born to die, yes, eventually,
yes,
you know. And it flowed from the fact that I was studying the topic of death and the fact that we start out, and the scripture says that the day of one's death is greater than the day of one's birth, you know. So, you know, it's all pointing to an end point. And we have to get as much accomplished, not for ourselves, but for Yahusha. So it's who we're living for that really matters. And that's the whole point of life. If we understand that it's not about us, it's a matter of who we live for. If we live for ourselves and sow to the flesh, then we're going to reap death, eternal death. But there is a first death and there's a second death, and you don't want the second death. The second death ends itself in the lake of fire. But if you live for your creator, you know, and you live for Yahusha. He's constantly on your mind. When you wake up, he's the first one. And your first thing that you do in your heart is thank him and say another day. Because, you know, every time we go to sleep, we're rehearsing for our big sleep. The big sleep. Well, you die, and then you wake up. And then you die, and then you wake up. Well, that's what sleep is. And death is a sleep. As much as people want to argue about it, that's really what Yahusha calls it. You know, we actually seem to go to sleep, and we know nothing about being in the world until we are awakened. And then he awakens us when he says, come out. And then we come out. And hopefully it won't be at the Great White Throne Judgment. But even if it is, there's going to be a determination made, and a few people's names will be in the scroll. But we want to aim for that first resurrection at his coming, you know, when the Feast of Sukkoth is fulfilled, you know. Anyway, I hope you all have a wonderful, you know, Simchat Torah day.
Yes, it's now finished.
It is. Yeah, it's over for you. That's right. You're in Australia. The earth is turning. It's different all over the earth.
Us Vikings.
Well, I think we're Vikings here, too.
Okay.
But, yeah.
You'll have to go into that a bit more deeply next week. Well, the Viking thing, that's fascinating.
Isn't it? Well, we love you guys.
Yeah, love you too, mate.
And hope you guys get a good night's sleep.
Yes.
Better check on your little one.
Yes. Oh, yeah, so Amy dealt with that. Dealt with him. Yeah. So, you have a good day, mate.
Okay, you too. And we'll talk to you next week.
Yep,
okay?
See you next week.
Good night.
Bye-bye.